Hi folks, this is Jake from Tier 3 Tactical. Today in this video we're going to be talking about women in combat, science, research, and a common sense analysis. Much of this video is going to revolve around some research, and I find that this particular topic is very emotional for a lot of people, vets, civilians, whoever, and there are a lot of opinions floating around out there, but if you've seen any of my videos or read any of my articles, I prefer to make my opinion based upon some research and logic. The point of this video is not to say yes or no, but to provide some evidence and let you make your own conclusion. First thing you need to ask yourself is, should you even listen to me? If you've read my bio, that's going to be linked on the website in the description below, you'll know that I did serve in the Marine Corps and I did hold two military occupational specialties, or MOSs. I was a qualified infantry officer and a ground intelligence officer. So that's a ground combat role and a support role. And I have deployed to Afghanistan. So I have a kind of unique perspective in terms of having done both a support and a combat role. And I've been to the schools for both and done training and deployed. So I can tell you that the lifestyle for each of those is different. As a ground intel officer, I spent a lot of my day doing staff functions, going to meetings, reading reports, planning intelligence operations. I held a desk down. As an infantry officer, I spent a large portion of my day planning training or operations, hiking with loads in excess of 100 pounds, running live fire ranges, and running my weapons platoon. Infantry life is, without a doubt, 100% more difficult. Back in around 2014-2015, when the military is mandated to open up all occupational specialties to women, the Marine Corps put together a very thorough and comprehensive study. I've linked the study in the article down below in the description, and if you want to read it, you're a glutton for punishment. It is over 950 pages, but it is a very comprehensive study. Let's go over some of the key points that you might need to know. Overall, all male squads, teams, or crews demonstrated a higher performance level, 69% of tasks. Gender-integrated teams performed better than their all-male counterparts in only two events. In terms of speed, all male squads, regardless of infantry MOS or non-infantry MOS, were faster than gender-integrated squads. This was more pronounced in infantry crew-served weapons like machine guns, mortars, or rockets, as they have to carry more ammunition and associated specialty equipment. All male 0311, which is the code for infantrymen, all male infantrymen had better accuracy compared to gender integrated squads. M4 accuracy was fairly close, but any other weapon system was quite a bit different. So that's it. No women in the military should be in ground combat roles, right? Well, I wouldn't necessarily save that. Let's get to the meat and potatoes of the study, because it does bear looking into. The Marine Corps did a very thorough job of planning this out. It took, you know, just about a year to do the whole thing, to put out an announcement, to gather volunteers, to form this unit, which was called the GCEITF, Ground Combat Element Integrated Task Force, or Training Force, whatever that was. They put them together, and crucially, they provided infantry training to the women who volunteered for this study, because you can't expect someone with no training to outperform someone who is a school-trained infantryman. It just won't happen. It doesn't matter your gender. So they did provide them a several-month training phase, and then after that, they moved them out to the 29 Palms Desert Warfare Training Center for some training, and then they moved into the evaluation phase there. Now, in this nearly 1,000-page study, they looked at everything from infantry to tanks to AAVs and artillery, anything in between. I'm not an expert in those fields, so I'm not really going to cover those. I'm going to stick to what I know best, which is the infantry, because I was a weapons platoon commander, and yes, I did graduate from infantry officer's course. So what we're going to cover is one of the better experiments that kind of demonstrates how they evaluated everything. If you check out the image below, you'll see a scheme maneuver for the infantry, basically an infantry assault. You can see that all units started in the start position. They're wearing a combat load, which is about 30 pounds of just body armor, ammo, and their weapon. And then they moved into their assault positions. Now, the crew-served weapons, the small, which is a rocket, or mortars, or machine guns, kind of moved directly into support by fire or the mortar firing position without going straight to the 8-foot wall obstacle. The regular infantrymen went straight to that wall. And if you'll see in the video here that the Marines are, or in the video that will follow this, the Marines had to traverse that wall and then go ahead and assault through the objective. At the end of that assault, they have to carry casualties. And these are realistically weighted dummies, and they carry them, I think it's like 100 yards. But check out the full video for that, and then research will have all that information. And the goal was twofold. They evaluated the time to get into these positions and conduct the assault, as well as things like accuracy. And they noticed quite a big difference in terms of time, and specifically some of the methods that were being forced to use. So general integrated squads, when they approach that 8-foot wall, a lot of times the men would just throw their assault pack on top and then climb up. The women couldn't do this by themselves, and that kind of slowed down the assault. Machine gunners, with only two women per team, were 20% slower than males, and that is kind of, it didn't seem like a huge deal, but I can tell you that is a huge deal for an assault. When you conduct a platoon level assault like this, you need to have machine guns in place to suppress the enemy, or else you're going to get killed. In terms of the straight regular infantry squads, with one or two females per squad, they were only about 5% slower, so not a huge difference there. But that wall traverse was a part that probably slowed them down, and they did note that any crew surf weapon team with females on it was much slower.
On the first day of the assessment, we assaulted through our initial three objectives, and that was the one-click hike up to the conics box. We then proceeded as a fire team and then a squad level to go over the conics box. We did a 180 until we were told to get up and get online and movement to contact. And then when we did movement to contact, we just walked another half a click before we actually contact was initiated, and we proceeded to accomplish the third objective. Once we accomplished the third objective and we got online, and I was a team leader at this point, I got my team on the right side to get up and move to the far right lateral limit. And then we stood by to take the casualty up to the, which would technically be the fourth objective. We would do the buddy carry to take the casualty from point A to point B, and then from point B, two other of my fire team would take it back to point A. From there, we would go ahead and get behind the berm, and we would let the engineers go up and do their thing, which was blow up some UXO.
The next piece of the evaluation was the accuracy. So once they had engaged the enemies, and the way that you do this in the Marine Corps, an attack is called buddy rushing. So you sprint about 10 meters, flop on the ground, shoot your target. Sprint 10 meters, flop on the ground, shoot your target. They do this for 300 meters, wearing 30 plus pounds of equipment. It's incredibly taxing. It's one of the hardest things you'll do. And yeah, after 300 meters of this, you're just going to be just ruined for about an hour after that. In fact, I'm probably getting PTSD just thinking about it. But in this portion, they checked the accuracy of the weapons. They found that male 0311 regular infantrymen hit their target 42% of the time. Males in the provisional infantry role, not school-trained infantrymen, actually were slightly more accurate, which is interesting to me, 44% accurate. Females that were carrying the M4 rifle, who were acting as infantrymen, only 28% accurate. So big difference there. And they saw that accuracy drop off as the weapon system got a little bigger or had higher recoil. So basically, with the easiest weapon to shoot, they were, you know, about 14% less accurate, which is a noticeable difference. Let's talk about some other key points. If you recall, they were required to evacuate a casualty. They found that females, integrated groups, were much slower to evacuate the casualty, to the point of if you carried a small rocket, you were over 170% slower. Machine gunners were 77% slower. Male units were roughly the same, but there was a big difference in how they were able to evacuate the casualty. Many squads or teams preferred just to have one male Marine, carry the dummy in a fireman's carry. And then that really wasn't an option for female integrated teams. They had to at least use a couple, two, three, sometimes four Marines to do that. And it slowed them down. And as you might imagine, in a combat environment, if you take more people to evacuate a casualty, you have less people being able to return fire or do other useful combat tasks. In terms of other key findings, the injury rate was the biggest one I noticed. It's very common to be injured in the infantry world. It's more of a when rather than an if. And researchers found that male Marines reported an 18.8% musculoskeletal injury rate. Females reported 40.5%. So roughly double. And this doesn't sound like a big deal, and it may or may not be. It's a lot of times these are something like a rolled ankle or a strained back muscle or something like that, and they'll get better with time for the most part. But I can tell you from personal experience that the longer this goes on, the longer the operation is, the longer these small injuries become, you know, things that you have to evacuate someone for. It means you have to stop combat operations to perform a casualty evacuation. So that is a big difference. That means you're probably going to lose double the amount of Marines you would normally lose through no enemy action. And so that's significantly going to affect your combat power. Lastly, you know, the question is, should women become infantrymen? And to be honest with you, that is the wrong question to ask. It's not should women become infantrymen, it's which women should become infantrymen. Anyone familiar with basic biology understands that men, on average, are larger, stronger, and have better endurance anaerobically and aerobically. That's why they don't compete together in functional fitness, and they don't compete together in the Olympics, in combat sports, or anything like that. This is not a dig against women. This is just how biology works. But to be honest, that is also kind of irrelevant. I don't really care what your gender is as an average. As a former platoon commander, I didn't give a rat's ass, you know, what you should or shouldn't have been. I care how you actually were. Were you an asset to the team? And I trained and worked with several females that were physical specimens and could regularly kick most male Marines' asses in terms of physicality. I see no reason why those women could not have gone through infantry training and deployed in an infantry ground combat role. To be sure, there weren't very many of those female Marines that could do that. But if they could do that and they passed the test, I don't see why they wouldn't be an asset to the team. So a common sense solution to this would be to establish a reasonable physical fitness standard based upon the job of, say, infantry or whatever you're looking at, and then ruthlessly hold that standard. And let anyone who wants to give it a go, give it a go. Let them sink or swim on their own. I don't see why that isn't the standard. You don't need to help women out. Women are plenty capable of doing the work and, you know, getting in good enough shape to pass those tests. Now, those tests are incredibly grueling. I don't think a lot of women realize how grueling they are or how likely you are to get injured. But for those that can get through them, good on you. Welcome to the Fleet Marine Force. My final thoughts on this are, I think women will be, you'll start to see them trickle into ground combat roles. I don't think there's a lot of women that particularly want to be in infantry or special forces roles. Surely there are some. And if they do the work and they can pass those tests and they get, you know, they deserve to be there, then let them be there. But I can tell you from my time in the Marine Corps, they started up, when I was in Afghanistan, a Lioness program where they would take women from support MOSs and they trained them to integrate with infantry Marines. And their job was to talk to female Afghans and children, because in their culture, outside males cannot do this. And their goal was to gather information or do outreach, you know, to the locals. And they did a lot of great work. They gathered a lot of intelligence on Taliban enemy activity, and they helped out a lot of people. But it was a pain because you had some women that were in great shape and blended into the team pretty well. Some women that you literally had to like carry all of their equipment and drag them to the position to get them to do their job. And that's just slowing everyone down. And to be honest with you, no one on the team wants to deal with someone who's like a lead anchor, right? So how much better would that have been to have female infantrymen who had already qualified to be in that unit, and they could have already done that without having to train them up, without having to have people that were a liability to the unit. So I don't see any reason why conflicts of the future that women won't play a role. Women can surely be in dangerous situations and they can perform just as well as men. I don't think there's as many women who want to do that or might qualify to do that. But if they do, and if they have the drive to do it and they pass those tests, let them take part in any job a man could qualify for. If you like this article, please like and subscribe.